Hi, everybody. It's a pleasure to present here. I guess I'm one of very few people without proper English accents. I was born in Russia, in Siberia, of all places, and live in California, lived in the US for the last 26 years. As you would see in the presentation, the company is quite international, and that actually is a significant strength, because what we do is we capture the attention of the best startups before they're well known. And so this gives us an opportunity to invest pretty early, to invest in deals that typically are reserved more or less to the recent Horowitzes and Sequoias of Silicon Valley. And as hopefully the presentation will demonstrate, we do quite well for a company that listed 10 years ago. This data is from our latest report. However, the market cap is indeed significantly higher right now. The price per share is significantly higher right now, about 50% of what it is on this slide. What we have done in the last 10 years is really turning a pretty small nifty, if I could say so, startup venture capital company into a company that enjoys significant recognition in the segments where we invest. And I will try to persuade you in this presentation that what we've been doing for the last 10 years has been not only successful numerically, but actually prepared a pretty good foundation for hopefully continued success in the coming few years. A quick look at the shares. Once again, you could much faster than I open the slide look at how shares are doing. This is as of December. Right now, things are significantly better, and indeed the company enjoys a market cap and the price that is about 50% higher than what it is on this slide. The team definitely sets us apart. Myself and Yuri are two key people of the company who are based in the United States, Yuri in Boston, myself in San Francisco. My background is a very active angel investor, over 100 deals, and the creator of several reasonably large startups, the biggest being Fotki.com with 25 million users. Yuri's background is as a senior VP at Barclay, Lehman, and Citibank. We also have a support team in former Soviet Union, in Russia, Ukraine, and a couple of other places. It really helps us significantly to capture the attention of fast-growing young startups and to get valuations that are much more advantageous than the typical valuations you get when companies get to rounds B and C. We also have a good presence in both European Union, mostly the Baltics in Israel, and in the United Kingdom, where our executive director, Alexander Selaginov, is based in London. If you look at our investment process, I would say it's rather well formalized, and what we believe in is in creation of a significant deal flow, so that as an investor, we don't need to invest in good enough deals, but rather we have to say no to quite a few pretty good deals just because we see deals that are better. What, as you all know, what a huge deal flow is really helpful with is, as an investor, you see quite a lot of alternative deals. So you know a lot about different business models, about different customer acquisition strategies, and you don't just listen starry-eyed to another wonderful startup telling you that it's absolutely unique, because chances are you've seen quite a few absolutely unique startups that are doing almost the same. But this huge funnel that we've developed over years through connection with angel investors, accelerators, other VCs, through a lot of work, including a lot of pro bono and nonprofit work with startups, really helps us in understanding both the segments where we invest, as well as in discovering the new segments where, you know, from time to time, VCs typically learn that it makes sense to discover new opportunities and to boldly go where no other investors seemingly have gone before. This again is a little bit outdated. The value we created is much more significant by now, but it sort of gives you a snapshot as of a few months ago in December of 2020, where we invested, how much we generated. We had 14 profitable exits, which is pretty unusual for an early stage VC company. We were the very first investors in three unicorns, which is also very unusual for an early stage VC company. These are Bolt, probably most known by most of the listeners here, because it's pretty active in London, so I don't need to explain what they do. It's Rike, which was acquired by Citrix for $2.25 billion several months ago. And it's Pipedrive, which was acquired by Vista, one of the largest private equity companies in the US, for $1.5 billion. We were the very first VC investors in all three, and strategically what we're trying to do is to be the very first VCs in fast-growing companies. And in order to achieve this, what we're doing day and night literally is hunting for great deals, hunting for great startups, networking, participating in panels and conferences, creating our own gatherings, seminars, just basically offering free help to a lot of startups. If you look at our portfolio, and this is after several big exits, the largest by far company is Backblaze. It's a competitor of Amazon S3, Google, Microsoft in providing online storage, only it does it at about 20-25% of the price that Google and Amazon offer. And it has over 500,000 of paying subscribers, both businesses and individuals storing a lot of data. It's Bolt, which I already mentioned. It's Deposit Photos, which is world's fourth or fifth largest photo stock and video stock agency. It's Sandbird, one of the largest perfume subscription businesses, 500,000 of paying users. It's PandaDoc, which is a document management software, and it's a whole bunch of other companies. What's really interesting about this portfolio is that the companies, five top companies comprising more than 75% of our holdings, grew last year in revenues at more than 65%. So you could argue that the best is yet to come, although of course this is a forward-looking statement. In terms of where we invest, we really mostly favor segments where we learned that the incumbents are not too strong and too oppressive, where we learn that there are quite a few deals possible, where we see pretty active M&A market, and where M&A multiples really encourage us to invest more. So as you can see for yourself, big data, software as a service, e-commerce, specifically subscription, edutech, and marketplace are really the main areas where we invest, mostly for those reasons. No oppressive incumbents, lots of opportunities for companies to grow, very active M&A professionals there, and pretty attractive M&A multiples. So we will probably continue in those five areas, and you see this little other. And what that means is that from time to time, we do discover new segments where we try to find a lot of new companies to invest in.
One minute left.
Oh, great. I'm pretty much done. This is a snapshot of the portfolio of some of the companies are more advanced, others less. These are notable revaluations of the companies that we have in the portfolio. As you see, quite a lot of significant ones. This is a list of our exits, all of which are quite profitable. And this is a list of large venture capital companies investing after us. Some accolades by the press, and you know, happy to answer any questions about TMT.
Okay, so those accolades, hopefully more will come, because you said the best is yet to come. Possibly forward-looking statement, which takes me to Darren Nathan's question. He says, Iga, how has your sector focus evolved over the last decade, and what might be the next big thing?
That's an excellent question. Thank you. I think, again, like I said, the main reason why our outlook on the markets continue to evolve is because we see new opportunities, new tech, and a lot of new M&A activities. I would say we started paying a lot more attention to fintech. We started looking more into education. We actually, in the past, only made one investment, and in the recent past, we made quite a few more. We will probably see a lot of activity in virtual reality and augmented reality, and we see how e-commerce is just totally eating up retail. So hopefully we'll make more bets there.
Okay, let's go to the competition. Niall Pearson says, hello. Now, how fierce is the competition to provide growth capital into exciting companies? And how do you differentiate yourselves from larger VC private equity houses?
I would say that this slide with a lot of billion-dollar plus investors following up on our investments probably answers the question the best. There are dozens of billion-dollar plus VCs that follow up on our investments. I would say on the one hand, yes, indeed, the competition is quite fearsome. But on the other hand, most of these companies invest in rounds B, C, et cetera, and they don't really realize such significant increases in valuation, right? When you invest in companies at $300, $400 million, keeping in mind that only 5 to 10% of exits happen at billion-dollar valuation, you don't look to, you know, become multi-X company. And we increased our value significantly. Where we do sort of demonstrate more value is, as I mentioned, we have quite a lot of people in Eastern Europe, you know, specifically Ukraine, Belarus, Baltic Republics, Russia, former Soviet Union, where a lot of brilliant entrepreneurs are coming, but these are pretty tiny markets for them to do anything. So typically they're moving to where I live, which is San Francisco, or to where Yuri lives, Boston, New York, etc. And that's where we catch them. We also catch them because my co-founders co-founded the very first high-tech unicorn in Eastern Europe called RBC, so a lot of us are well-known by them.
Okay, final question is from Pavel Fedorov, who says, as electrical transport industry is on the rise already, are you planning to invest in this sector and in infrastructure for e-cars?
We are very actively monitoring those deals. We actually looked just a couple of weeks ago into a company in Silicon Valley that provides sort of a cloud electric charging for electric vehicles. We're quite interested, but decided not to go forward because it's requiring too much capital. We're a small VC firm. We definitely would look there. I want to say that we do not have yet much expertise. But in terms of expertise, this is definitely a top 10 area. So I would say we're looking there, but we haven't made any investments yet.
Okay, this is probably a yes or no answer due to time. Backblaze market rumors is that it's preparing for an IPO. Do you think that will happen?
I can't comment on that one.
Sorry. That's no problem at all. Shoyfoot investment partner at TMT Investments. Thank you very much indeed. That was a very unfair question. Finally, thank you very much.
Brilliant questions too. Cheers.
Thank you.